Project Horus is an amateur high-altitude ballooning group based in Adelaide, South Australia. It's a subgroup of the Amateur Radio Experimenters group, which the members of have been instrumental in designing and building radio equipment for the activities. Horus launched its first balloon back in 2010, and today this is designated launch number 60. This launch is part of the celebration of the 25th anniversary of AREG, and the special event callsign VI-25 AREG has been used for the main payloads. We've been on the retrieval side of many weather balloons, but this time we were going to be involved with the launch as well. The weather, on the other hand, was not playing along. Low cloud and a bit of rain would be making things difficult. But as we headed further up the freeway past the tunnel, the weather on this side of the hills actually seemed pretty decent. We're in with a chance here. Arriving at Mount Barker High School, who we had an arrangement with to use their oval as the launch site, we got out all of the equipment. A quick phone call to CASA to tell them that the launch was going ahead. Payloads had batteries installed, covers taped up, and were all tied together in a long string. Okay, now for the next bit. Two cylinders of helium.
What's in the box?
This is, of course, a little bit more serious than your average party balloon. But before we go ahead and fill the balloon, we need to do a few last checks on the string of payloads.
It's such a cheerful start, isn't it? Here comes some data!
A cut-down device in case the payload is going to land anywhere inadvisable or floats for too long. A parachute so the gear isn't smashed to bits when it hits the ground. The primary tracker, a repurposed radio sonde. Radiation sensor experiment, also a repurposed radio sonde with a radiation sensor on it. Helium network tracker, using the Helium LoRa network for positioning downlink. WeNet imaging payload, sending digital high definition pictures. And lastly, the SSTV imaging payload, which sends analog low definition pictures. All ready to go? Let's fill the balloon. Although hydrogen gives you more lift, we're using helium here because, unlike hydrogen, it's not flammable. The approval from CASA, in fact, is conditional on the balloon being filled with helium.
Well, that's $400 of helium.
People say golf is expensive.
And that is a big downside. This much helium is, in fact, quite expensive.
Yeah, this is the end. That's it.
Just stick one more in here.
Okay.
On the table tie.
God, it's been a while, hasn't it? Yeah, I'm trying to tape over everything sharp. Yeah, there's some neck lift in that.
So the launch, well, it's not actually quite as simple as just letting go of everything. It's a slightly more fiddly process of kind of feeding it up into the air. A last minute check that everything's securely tied together and ready to go. You don't want the imaging payloads to be tangled up and launched with the camera pointing in a bad direction, or for antennas to be folded back on themselves. A favourable row angle was achieved, and now it is just as simple as letting go.
3, 2, 1.
End of it's whipping around, doesn't look like there's that much wind, but
what exactly is a row angle? It's named for the amateur radio software developer David Rowe, but there's a story.
And we were ready to launch and we were getting these terrible gusts, right? It was just every few minutes, really hard to pick, we'd get this wind gust of like 10 knots or whatever, and the whole balloon would lean over. We get this pause, we're like, excellent, let's go, we let it up. It's just drifting up, the wind gusts and the whole thing leans over and it goes into those trees right over there. In which the balloon barely clears it, it rips off half the payload train, and the rest of the flight continued on. except now it was half the payload weight that it was supposed to be. So its ascent rate was enormous and the whole thing just became a complete disaster. It was wild. So now, yeah, we are very, very mindful of how long the payload train is and what the ground winds are. Today was perfect. Today was absolutely perfect.
With the balloon launched, we pack everything up and head on. So, Act 2, the chase. First, a quick stop to lose the trailer. So this little display up here shows the current altitude of the balloon, useful to know how the flight's going. Checking the landing prediction, we head out past Talem Bend to be near the predicted landing site. At 10 kilometers altitude, we watch the display switch from meters to kilometers. The images it's collecting look pretty decent so far. As it draws further overhead, we switch receive antenna.
Yes. By, 5 to 8 dB. Cool. Wow, we're at almost 20 dB SNR.
You realize you can just overlay these up, right? Of course. But you gotta capture the experience.
Oh, wow, that's fully sideways.
We'll have a few moments, so it's time to stop in at the local bakery for lunch.
No! What?
No!
Oh no.
How is
a bakery closed on Sundays?
What? And only open in the morning on Saturday. So the bakery distance factor just got a few dB worse.
Ye really did.
Yeah, going to place you'll get a pie there. Is it one of the on the runs, Mark? Over.
Right. Looks like the petrol station. It is there.
Okay.
The boat has to remain within a 100-meter circle because otherwise CASA won't give us an approval.
Well, yeah, radius on launches.
I think the concept of just do it outside the 3-mile limit may be limited to the goodies episodes.
Might be.
Suggest international borders, right?
Sorry, but the Snowy Mountain Hydro Scheme has already invented the concept of a pirate radio sond.
Oh, 3-4. There we go.
Yep, that's first. 3-5, 3-4-8-6.
So at this point, we want to find a close spot to the landing site. We know roughly where it's going to land, and it's going to be nowhere near the road. So we drive up to the farmhouse to talk to the property owners, explain what we're doing, show them the map, and ask permission to retrieve the balloon. We do, of course, hope that they say yes, which they did. Jumped in the ute and asked us to follow. Up on the ridge, as per their advice, we caught a very brief glimpse of it before it landed somewhere in the canola field.
Oh good god, here, let me get there.
And we know the SFTD payloads can see a tree.
Well, that's a tree.
Treading very carefully to avoid trampling the crop, and walking in single file, we retrieved the payload successfully.
Wow, that was actually surprisingly
single file.
Oh well.
The batteries come out, the payloads are deactivated, but there's one final tradition. Position the imaging payload so it takes a group photo of the recovery crew as the last image it uploads.
That's better, no one's staring at their phones on this one.
Look, it's a box with some stuff in it.
And an actual camera with an actual lens.
Yeah.
Are you ready for your recap interview?
Yeah. And today Michaela's going to be playing the part of Graham Norton. 5-minute walk in, most of the data and everything came down great. All the payloads seem to work. Still having that GPS unlock on the SSTV payload.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with that. But that was one of the new GPS receivers
as
well.
That's extra weird.
That was indeed a success, so now it's just time to head back. Thanks to Project Horus and the Amateur Radio Experimenters Group for the balloon launch, and thanks to the Crouch family for letting us onto their farm. Until next time, don't forget to like, comment and subscribe, and see you next time.